Turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Romans, chapter number 12. Amen. I've preached this before, and not this message, but this verse before. I'm finding myself very challenged these days to go back and revisit the familiar, to find the unfamiliar. I love that. Praise God. Our lives are a wonderful place to display the presence of God. I shared something this evening, Sister Susan, as you were sharing. I remember something. Long before I met you and knew you, you waited on me at Walmart. When no one else seemed to know what was going on, and after a very long, long wait, here comes Sister Susan, and she knows exactly where our order is, and she gets it, and is the most pleasant lady in the world. She probably doesn't remember, but I thanked her for being so nice. Jesus shines through. No matter where we are, Jesus shines through. And so, know that you're showing the love of God and how important it is. And who would know, Sister Susan, our paths would cross and such a, but God was reflected from through you and the one back then. Amen. Romans chapter number 12, familiar passage of Scripture, but oh, the Lord can help us tonight if He can bring it home to us. I like what Brother David said. Folks being broken around the altar. That was beautiful this morning, seeing folks pray and cry and tarry and realize they could trust God even though they didn't understand the plan of God. I'll say this. I preached on this morning Abraham and Isaac differently than I've ever looked at it before, that there's a test. And there's a testing, there's a test, and there's a trusting, and there's a triumph. And the test is sometimes we don't understand, and it's not what we had anticipated. One of the things I shared, that I didn't share the message because racing the clock, is, you know, none of us think about life being that we would bury our children. No, because life doesn't work that way. We outlive our children as parents, right? Or that's what the rule of thumb tells us it should be. And so here it is, everything the contrary for Abraham. This isn't what he anticipated. But he still trusted God, and he was obedient. Amen. Tonight, once again, as we embrace the Word of God, what we're about to read here in Romans, we can trust Him, even when it seems to go against the standard of what should be. Or even what our ideas are, we can trust Him. How about it? Amen. He's trustworthy. And He always causes us to triumph. I beseech you therefore, brethren, here Paul is, he is begging and pleading. He said, what I beseech you by is the mercies of Christ, the mercies of God, let me say it correctly, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Let's just stop right there. Let me give you a little bit of humor before we move on. How about that? A little humor is good, right? Amen. This morning I told you, I went to a conference. My wife and I, through work, have to go to conferences every so often. And so she can get her continuing ed as well. And so we went and we listened to a pediatric emergency room doctor who is also a minister, and she teaches in a seminary, and she's wonderful. Dr. Pat Fossarelli, I love her. And she was talking about how important it is that, chemically speaking, that when we laugh, that our brains produce in our body endorphins. I said that this morning, and those endorphins are things like morphine, that those things that stimulate us and make us feel good. So scientifically proven, God's word even says laughter that doeth good like a medicine, Brother David. So let the endorphins be produced, right? Amen. All right, so smile and laugh. But the story is told about two men from New York who had grown up there, Candy, all their life, and they decided they were tired of city life. So they decided that they were going to sell everything they had, Sister Susan, and they were going to move to Texas. They were going to buy themselves a farm, and they were going to work as their ancestors worked. And so that's exactly what they did. They decided that they were going to live off the land, bought themselves a farm. And so they decided in the middle of all this, that Brother Eli, they needed a mule. They needed a mule, so they went by to a neighboring rancher farmer, and they said to him, and they said, "Do you know where we can buy a mule?" He said, I don't have a mule." He said, "I don't even know where you can get one from." So in the middle of their talking, they looked over and they saw against the barn there were these round things, and they didn't know what they were. They were honeydews, and so they said to the farmer, "Well, what is that over there against the barn?" He said, "Oh, those are mule eggs." And they said, "Well, hey, we'll take one. We'll buy one." So in the course of their buying a mule egg, they wanted to get themselves a mule. They decided that they would put it in the back of their truck, and they took off driving. And all of a sudden, they're driving, they hit a bump, and guess what? That old mule egg flew out, it hit the ground, and busted everywhere. And they looked in the rearview mirror and seen that they had lost their mule egg. So they decided to stop and go back for it. In the meantime, one of those great big Texan jackrabbits decided that he was going to go up and he was going to eat off of that honeydew. And as he was eating off of it, they looked and they said, "Look, our mule egg has hatched. There's our baby mule." So they went running after this. All of a sudden, the jackrabbit saw it. He took off in every direction. They were running, 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 trying to catch this mule egg that hatched. And soon before they knew it, they were exhausted. Jackrabbit was gone. And one fellow looked over at the other. He said, "You know what? I'm not so sad about that anyway. I didn't want a mule that would plow that fast." But one thing for sure, they were determined. You gotta give it to them for determination, right? And so when we look at this word of God, as they were committed to getting a mule, believing anything, doing anything, Paul makes an appeal that asks for commitment. As crazy as it may be, being committed. As we look here, I want us to look at several things. I want to break this apart, just this one verse this evening. Here as Paul writes, and he says there is an appeal that we must appreciate. He said, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God. That word beseech is to plead or to appeal or to beg. So Paul is begging with them. He's appealing to them. And then he says, who is he appealing to? It's to this audience. He said, brethren. Amen. He's writing to a group of people, amen, that believe in the power of God and has been transformed by the presence and the power of God and the blood of Jesus Christ. And he said, I beg of you, brethren. Amen. I beg of you by the mercies of God, amen, that you would do something. Amen. Beseech you therefore. Anytime there's a therefore in the scripture, amen, there's something that we got to look at. The therefore takes us back to the mercies of God. I beseech you. Amen. By what? I beseech you by the mercies of God. Amen. I bet that you present yourself a living body. Why does he beg? Because of the mercies of God. How many of you here experience the mercies of God?
over and over and over and over again. Our minds probably cannot even recollect all the times the mercies of God has worked and moved in our life. And so Paul was begging. He said, I beg of you by the mercies of God. Amen. I'm pleading with you by the mercies of God. And then let's read on. He says this. There's an active practice. He said that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. Amen. And what he's saying is this. He's saying when you think about everything that God has done for you, amen, is it too much to ask of you? As you think tonight of everything that God has done for you, is it too much to think about what you can do for God? Who you are, your life, your situations, your answered prayer, the mercies of God. That you present your bodies. It is an act that is voluntary. Amen. God is not twisting your arm to do it. So Caleb, he says, I beseech you by the mercies of God that you willingly or voluntarily, Sister Susan, to the pastor, I do it voluntarily. Present your body as a sacrifice. Amen. To God. Amen. When we give someone a present, amen. I come up to you and I say, I have something for you. I don't do it because Sister Holly's twisted my arm or for any other. I give you a present. I present to you because it is voluntary. Amen. So the Word of God says that we present. It's a present. Amen. That we give voluntarily to God. Amen. Because of His mercies, God, I voluntarily give back to you. I know sometimes, isn't it easy when someone has done something for you and you are appreciative to give them something? Think about your parents on birthdays or Father's Day, Mother's Day. Amen. The one that you love, Valentine's Day. You know, you can give because they've given so much to you. And so voluntarily giving back to them. Amen. It is a personal act that is done voluntarily. The personal act is our bodies, but it is a sacrificial act. It is a living sacrifice. And he gives some stipulations. I beg of you, amen, by the mercies of God, that you voluntarily present yourself a living sacrifice. But it needs to be holy and it needs to be acceptable, amen, unto God. In the Old Testament, the Jewish people, they presented as sacrifices animals unto God. But as Christians, believers, instead of giving something from outside of us, we give from inside of us. This is me. This is me. I give of me. God, I give of me, nothing outside of me, but from the very depth of my soul, I present to you me as a living sacrifice, but me. Hallelujah. What prompts, amen, our consecration? It's the mercies of God. It's the mercies that we give back to Him because He showed us mercy in the salvation of our soul. So our response is consecration. How can you give to God the way that you do? How can you trust God when you don't understand? How, when God speaks to your heart, can you not procrastinate like Abraham? Like Abraham did not do, but you immediately rise up and go and do what God, because it's by the mercies of God that I present myself as a living sacrifice. And I feel the presence of God that we present ourselves as a living sacrifice. Nothing outside of me, but everything that is within inside of me. Have you ever been in the presence of God to where the very inside of you, your soul begins to cry out, your soul begins to worship, your soul begins to give to God because God's your mercies. And so I present to you the very depth of me. It's interesting because there's almost an argument that we can ponder here. He says, which is your reasonable service? Consecration, but what is my reasonable service? What is that? Yes, folks, and it may be different on different levels and different people, but I like what the songwriter wrote. He said, when I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss and pour contempt on all my pride. Where the whole realm of nature mine that were at present far too small, love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all. Amen. I give to Him everything from the very depth of my soul. It is my living sacrifice unto Him, because Brother David, He showed His mercies unto me. Amen. And so Paul says, I beseech you, I beg of you, amen, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is our reasonable service. It is said of Queen Mary, a Queen of Scotland, that she loved to go out without protective services, and she would go and she would visit with folks. One day she was out and she was making her way to the town, Brother David, and as she was there, the storm clouds began to arise, and she knew it was going to rain, so she went up to her house and she knocked on the door. And as she knocked on the door, she said, could I ask of you, in her commoner clothes, she said, could I ask of you to beg, I need an umbrella, could you give me an umbrella? I will bring it back tomorrow. The woman looked at her and she thought, I certainly will not give her my best umbrella. So she looked and she found an umbrella that was broken. The fabric was worn and some holes in it, and she handed it to her. And there, the Queen of Scotland, Mary, said to her, thank you so much. I will return this to you tomorrow. And the next day, there was a knock on that lady's door, and there was an honorable servant of the Queen. And he said to the lady, she said, I am returning your umbrella. The Queen of Scotland appreciates that you gave it to her yesterday. All of a sudden, in dread, the lady was standing in the door, and she thought, oh, my, how humiliated I am that I didn't give better and I didn't give my best to the Queen of Scotland. I wonder what it will be like when we stand before God someday. Amen. And He says, how has it been for you to present yourself, amen, as a living sacrifice, which is holy and acceptable unto God? Don't miss an opportunity to give your very best to the King. Amen. It is an opportunity every day to give your best to the King. And then there's an attitude that we've got to possess. It's this, and be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. One man said it this way, don't let the world wrap around you and squeeze you to its mold. God, I want you to transform me by the renewing of my mind. You know what that is? That's an opportunity tonight when we get ready to come to prayer. Not to come and give your wish list to God. All those things that are burdensome, God is concerned about them. But it's saying, all my petitions aside, God, now Brother David, I come and surrender. Transform me. Renew my mind. Here is my vessel. Take all of me, every bit of me, a living sacrifice. Let it be whole. And let it be acceptable unto you. Listen, folks like to fit into society. We all fall in a little bit of a realm of that. You know why? Because every one of us probably wears something that's a little modern for the day and hour, because society kind of dictates that we don't dress like it was in the 1920s, right? And so there are things, amen, but we can't allow the things of this world to creep in, amen, as we come to God in prayer. And as we allow our inside, amen, to be yielded to God and not conform to this world. Amen. The things of this world, the loyalty of this world is not to God. Amen. So their thinking is not toward God. But God has called us to be loyal unto Him. The difference between us and the world is that the cross has come between us and them. Hallelujah. Do you hear me? The difference between us and this world is that the cross has come between us and them. You know, sometimes, you know, I can become, at my job, weary, you know, meeting the demands of people at times. But the thing that I want to always be different, sometimes people have said, well, you're just a pushover. No, it's me inside. You need to take care of me and yielding to meet people's needs because my life is not like the world's. Amen. My life has a cross. Amen. That will not allow me to cross over certain barriers. I've not been conformed to the world, but I've been transformed by the renewing of my mind. Ah, transformed tonight. Transformation is the remedy for conformation. Amen. If you don't want to conform to the things of this world, amen, the only way to stop it is being transformed by the renewing of your mind. Be renewed tonight over and over and over again. One thing I love about God is He's all about renewal and restoration. Amen. He's the God of re tonight. Amen. He will renew us and restore us. Amen. And we need it. Transformation means much more than our manners, but it's a change in our mind as Christians that affects our attitude. And then there's an achievement that we must pursue that we may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. That word prove is to test, scrutinize, to examine, amen, the experience of being the will of God. It's good, it's acceptable, and it's perfect. Wow, do you hear me tonight? Brother David, that's where we can live. Amen. In the good, the acceptable, and the perfect. You know why? Because we've proved God. Amen. As we've been transformed, He has changed us. How many of you want to live in good? How many want to live in acceptable? How many want to live in perfect? Amen. You know, like kind of like those childhood stories, once upon a time, and they lived happily ever after. You know how the happily ever after comes? Amen. As we give to God, and we're not conformed, but we're transformed, and then we prove, amen, that the will of God is perfect and acceptable and the place to be.
Amen.
Acceptable. Amen. We'll never find the ways of God obnoxious. Never. Saint of God, you hear me? We'll never find the ways of God obnoxious because they're always acceptable to the one who loves God. Amen. It's good. We never need to fear the consequences. Amen. It's acceptable. It's never obnoxious. Amen. It is perfect. Amen. We can never improve on the plan of God. We can't ours. But we'll never have to improve on God's plan. It is perfect. We see from the point of the present, but He sees past, present, and future, and through all eternity. So it is perfect. There's an appeal that we must appreciate the mercies of God. Do you appreciate them tonight? There's a practice that we must have, and that is consecration. There's an argument that we must ponder. What is our reasonable service? There's an attitude that we must possess. and that is transformation and not confirmation. And there's achievement we must prize, and that is proving the will of God. If Sister Beth would come to the end tonight, a Haitian pastor's told a story. The story is this for the day that there was a man who was trying to sell a house for a particular amount of money. As he was trying to sell his house, there was a man who wanted to buy it that simply could not afford the amount that the homeowner was asking for his home. So he said, the homeowner, to the man who was the prospect that buy, he said, you'll never be able to afford my house. You can't. You don't have the money. You don't have the backing to afford it. So I'll tell you what, I'll sell it to you for half the price. But I always get to own the nail that is over the front door. And if I want it back, I get it back. The man said, okay, that's a good deal. Half the price and you own one nail. That's a good deal. So he bought the house and, oh, Sister Rachel, he loved his new house. What a great deal, Sister Nancy. He got the house for half the price. Years passed and the previous homeowner, he come by. He said, I want my house back. He said, no. He said, the only thing that you own is the nail. The nail is yours. Anything that you want is yours with the nail. But I bought this house. You settled for the price. The previous homeowner said, okay, then we'll work according to the standards I want. So he went and he found a dead dog along the road. He came and he hung it on the one nail that he owned. Can you imagine as days and weeks went on what that smelled like? It was terrible. And so the man who had purchased the house, he had to move him and his family out because the stench was so great. The moral of the story is this, is that we have to give to God everything. We can't bargain with the enemy and say, I'm going to give to God everything, but I'm going to let the enemy have one nail. One nail can drive us away from being in the place where God wants us to be. The enemy will hold all kinds of stench and stink. And so God says, I want you to present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Tonight I'm not preaching about bringing your wallet. I'm not preaching about bringing your time. I'm not preaching about bringing your talents either. Although all those things apply, I believe. But tonight, the area that we're looking at is this. Is that God wants not what's outside of you, but He wants everything that's inside of you as a living sacrifice. Everything. He's not asking you to close the closet door and leave it a mess. God says all doors open with no reservation because of the mercies of God. Present yourself as a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God. The argument, what is our reasonable service? It's everything, Brother David. We can argue, but when we look at what God's done for us, it's everything. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed. Sunday night, we'll soon be back out. Schools, the workforce, we'll be back out into the week and into the world. Let's not be conformed to this world. Let's be transformed tonight. Because the cross has gotten our way. And everything about us is yielded wholly to God. One more minute, I'm bringing you on the altar. I'm not asking tonight for you to come, and God's not asking tonight for you to come with a little wish list. God is asking you to come with a yielded vessel that gives everything to God. And so would you come and find yourself a place at the altar.
and put your all on the altar as a living sacrifice that is your reasonable service. Paul said it. Pastor says it. I beg you by the mercies of God to come and present your bodies as a living sacrifice. Would you come tonight?